Hello, hello, Mordimer here, and welcome to another game of Airthings Masters. This time I would like to show you the game between Wesley So and Daniil Dubov. And just a reminder, 12 Grandmasters play in the round robin system, so everybody plays everybody once, only once. And then 8 of best of them gonna advance to the quarterfinals, to the knockout phase. And at the end of the video, I'm gonna show you all the standings, so what happened and who got how many points. And the last day, the third day of this preliminary stage, was just insane. From the first, the winners, there are three winners, they got the 6.5 points, and the last two players got 4.5 points, so only 2 points less than the winners out of 11. So this was just insane. So without further ado, let's see this exciting game. We have Wesley So with the white pieces, e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6. We have bishop b5, so Ruy Lopez on the board. We have a6, bishop a4, knight f6, and now castle. We have b5, bishop b3, bishop c5, and now a4, challenging this pawns, so rook goes to b8, and now we have c3, preparing of course d4, we have d6, and now we have d4 as planned, bishop b6, and now a takes on b5, a takes on b5, and knight a3, attacking this pawn on the b5, and just for your information, this pawn shouldn't be saved. Actually, it's possible to play b4, but black gonna get the worst position, and this knight gonna jump to the c4, and all of the things gonna collapse. So you just don't play b4 in this position. We have the castle, we have knight b5, so white actually is winning the pawn. However, keep in mind that this bishop in the right moment can strike in the center, and this knight is undefended. So very important information. If you play Ruy Lopez, we have bishop g4, now pinning the knight. We have rook e1, now defending this pawn, and this pawn was not taken before because of this double attack on both of the knight. So that would be, of course, the blunder. So bishop f3, g takes on f3, and now knight h5, making a space for the queen. This is the idea of that move. We have king h1, and now queen f6, putting a lot of pressure on d4. So we have four attackers together with the bishop and with the knight, and pawn and the queen, and it's only three defenders so far. So bishop e3 now defending, and this is still the theory, and it's well-known theory, a lot of games. E takes on d4, c takes on d4, and now bishop a5. So it looks like very dangerous for white, because bishop a5 attacking the rook, and as I said, this knight is under attack. However, this is still the theory, remember? So we have rook g1, and now rook b5 winning the piece temporarily, and now bishop a4 attacking the rook, and also the knight is behind. And this is very, very tricky. If you don't know the theory, you can fall into the trap. If you try to defend the rook, which is pretty natural, then of course we're gonna have bishop c6, rook c6, rook a5, winning back the piece. The problem is black are in the totally, you know, bad position. This knight is under attack, but it cannot retreat. That is the problem. You have to defend it, but it's also not that easy to defend, as these rooks and this bishop controls mostly of the squares around. So that is the huge problem. Queen h4 is the only way to defend the pawn, and then rook g4, the queen is under attack, queen h3. Now bishop g5 trying to win the queen. Black can save the piece, however, after f6, rook h4, a queen can escape to c8 and then play bishop h6. So pretty complicated stuff, but white have much better position. At the end, black gonna have this ugly pawn structure in front of the king, so completely lost position. So this is why rook b6 shouldn't be played. Just remember, if you play Ruy Lopez as black, that's not the way to play. The correct move is rook b2, and this is what Daniil Dubov of course played. Now bishop c6, getting back the material, and bishop b6. d6. So this bishop gets a very, very nice position, focusing on d4, and also this bishop cannot actually be attacked easily. So very nice spot for the bishop, also is defending c7. Now we have rook g4, and this is the 21st move of the game, and it's still the theory. We have one game in the database where Vasily Ivanchuk played against Alexei Shirov in 1997, 23 years ago, and the main idea was rook b4 going after that pawn. This is what Alexei Shirov played, and we had e5, and after d takes on e5, queen e7 had to retreat, queen d5, and after bishop e3, f takes on e3, g6, and the game ended with the draw. However, we have g6 by Daniil Dubov immediately, and now Wesley So tries to exploit that. So if the pawn is moved, then of course a very natural access point is f5 and h5. h5 is not possible to be played anymore because the knight is a really great defender here. It cannot be attacked easily there. So f4. We have rook b4, so the idea of course is on the board, now attacking this pawn the third time, but Wesley So said your rook is too active here, so rook a4, let's exchange. We have rook a4, queen a4, and now knight g7, taking under control f5. We have bishop d5, very sneaky move, bringing the bishop to this diagonal and pinning this pawn. So this pawn actually is not defender of g6 anymore. So there is only one defender, and black have to be very careful. Dubov moved the king to h8, so moving away from that pin. Now this pawn structure is pretty much solid again. We have h3 and now queen e7. We have f5 finally, and now how to defend the position. There are two ways, however playing queen f6 now it's a bit shaky here, because after f takes on g6, h takes on g6, rook f4, queen e7, black have to accept that the queen can come back, and you know, for example, together with the rook attack on the open h file, semi-open h file. So this can be inconvenient, but black have very nice knight e6 move, attacking the rook, and now white would have to decide, so give up the pair of bishops, which probably shouldn't be played, or move the rook. And if moving the rook only to the light squares, so that means blocking the movement of the queen. So you know, this is still playable for both of the sides, so one of the ways. However, Daniil Dubov decided that he want to win the pawn here. So we have g takes on f5, e takes on f5, knight f5, and now bishop g5, attacking the queen. And it's very, very tricky now, because if black are not careful here and play something like queen e8, we're gonna have very beautiful checkmate, and you should know that pattern. I hope you know, bishop f6, knight g7, bishop g7, king g8, bishop f6, and that's Pillsbury mate. So very, very important just to not get, you know, into Pillsbury mate. This is why we have f6 blocking the bishop, and now instead of moving the bishop, we have rook e4 first, attacking the queen. And this is the critical moment of the game, and black have to be extremely precise in the defense. So there are two ways of defending. One is a bit shaky because you exchange the rook and the bishop for the queen. So if you play f takes on g5, you're gonna lose the queen, and then continue from here. Of course, the bishop is attacking d4. The knight can come also and take this pawn. This pawn cannot be defended because we have the light square bishop. So this is the one way of playing. However, of course, mobility of the queen is just great, but black can try to, you know, set up some kind of fortress. The bishop is already on a really great position, defending the pawn on c7. These two pawns maybe can be very dangerous, so that was one way. The more natural way would be queen d8, very important move. Queen d8 is the saving the game move. Bishop f4, knight g7 could be played, and the game game could continue from here. It's still very difficult for white to find the entry point, and black also can counter attack, so it can be very, very tricky position. However, Daniil Dubov blundered the game and he played Queen G7. Now Queen G7 is a blunder. He missed one of the ideas, and this is the time where you can pause the video and find the only winning continuation for white while I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, ready? So the only winning idea here is actually Rook E8. The rook is defended, and also it cannot be exchanged because this bishop is controlling G8. So that would be the checkmate pretty soon. And if you just don't care about that and say, okay, if this rook's gonna be exchanged, the problem is, let's say you take the bishop, and then we have Queen A8 now attacking the rook again. And again, you cannot exchange, because you're gonna get checkmated, and if you try to make some space for the king, let's say h5, you're gonna lose not only the rook, but also after bishop e4, this knight is pinned and it's gonna be lost in the next game. So for example, bishop d4, and now bishop f5, king h6, and here the good thing for the black position is actually defending h8, so the rook cannot come to h8, that would be game over. However, white have queen e8, and now this is the problem because queen is coming to e6, and if we have g4 making some space for the king, it doesn't work because now, boom, this is winning, and this time this doesn't work because we have the checkmate on g6. So this move of the queen to g6 or to e6 is just winning. So that's the danger. So Daniil Dubov set up the trap. He didn't play f takes on g5. He set up the trap. He played bishop a7, blocking the advancement of the queen to a8. And now, of course, the bishop cannot be taken because rook is hanging. But Wesley so found the continuation, and I hope you found this as well. Extremely difficult, but look at this. Queen d7, sacrificing the queen. Boom. And this is very beautiful. You cannot take the queen because, of course, we're gonna have rook f8. And we're gonna have the checkmate as the bishop controls h6. So that's, of course, the checkmate. So this is why Dubov play h6, but now queen c8. So the queen couldn't get to a8, but this way advanced to the 8th rank. But now Dubov can exchange the rook. So we have rook e8, queen e8, king h7, and now I would like you to pause the video one more time because it's still winning for white, but there is only one move in this position which is winning. While I enjoy my cup of tea. Okay, ready? I hope you found it. Not that easy. However, after bishop f6, Daniil Dubov resigned. And this is the only winning move. Of course, the bishop cannot be taken because we're gonna have the checkmate. And also, if the queen moves somewhere else, we're gonna have the checkmate on h8. And any other moves, of course, losing the queen. If the queen is staying there, then the queen is lost and it's also game over. So this is why after bishop f6, Daniil Dubov resigned. What a game! But the game was insane, but also the round was insane. Look at this. Standings after preliminary stage. Magnus Carlsen, Wesley So, and Hikaru Nakamura. 6.5 points out of 11. So there was a lot of decisive games here. Jan Nepomniachtchi, Teimur Radjabov, 6 points. So also very, very solid. Levon Aronian, 5.5 points. And Maxim Vachier-Lagrave, who was already in the commentators in the studio, they said that he doesn't have even a single chance to advance, even mathematical. Then they just said, okay, maybe mathematical, that's possible, but practically it's impossible. But everything happened, like, you know, Maxim Vachier-Lagrave won with the black pieces with Alexander Grishuk, and then he got 5 points, the same amount what Grishuk have So Daniil Dubov also with the 5 points advance, very, very lucky. Pentala Hare Krishna, Alexander Grishuk, very unlucky in the last round, 5 points, but they didn't advance, that was not enough. And also Anish Giri and David Anton, 4.5 points. So as you see, Magnus Carlsen, Wesley Sohikaru Nakamura, 6.5 points, and the last two players, 4.5 points, only 2 points less. That's just incredible. And I'm gonna show you a quarterfinals, 8 players we know already. And if you like this video, press like. If for some reason you don't like it, press unlike. And if you don't want to miss other games from Airthings Masters 2020, press subscribe, smash the bell button. Thanks for watching and see you in the next one.